Peter Drucker, a famous management consultant and writer, once said that culture eats strategy for breakfast. And he didn't mean that strategy is not important for startups. What he meant was that culture might be a more powerful and more important way to success. Today we talk about startup culture with Elina Lappalainen. Hello.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. And Elina is a business journalist from Helsingin Sanomat. And Elina, what can you tell us about you?
Well, I have been a business journalist since 2009 or 10, and covered startups, growth companies, and technology more than 10 years. At the moment, I work in Helsingin Sanomat new business brand called HS Visio. It's kind of edgier, and we have our own voice for analyzing these issues like technology and startups and growth companies, but also investing in other business areas. It has been quite a journey with these Finnish business success stories. I have seen since the day one all the our unicorns like Supercell, Rovio, Smartly, Oura, Varjo, all the famous names that come from Finland. So there have been lots of learnings. Mm-hmm. And I have had also the job to dig deeper and sometimes also investigate the problems that are often caused by the culture. So this is very important.
This is a good topic for you.
Yes.
Yes.
So Elina, why is entrepreneurship important to you?
Well, first of all, for me it's important because I'm a gamer and geek girl, and I started to become interested about technology from that point, like personal view on being excited on all the digital. But then there are more like deeper societal reasons why the entrepreneurship is important. First, there's the technology. We are living age where things like new materials that are replacing fossils are very critical. We have the energy crisis, and technology can bring new solutions for energy problems. We need more solutions for proteins to replace animal-based food. So this kind of new technologies are important for us all, and that's what I'm excited about. But then there's the business and economic growth reason. These are the companies that are creating value to Finland. They are creating jobs, they are creating taxes, they are creating economic growth to fund the welfare state that we have. So those reasons, from being a geek girl to more broader the national benefit, I think all those reasons apply.
What are some positive aspects of the startup culture?
Sometimes I envy startup people who have the bravery, the strength to take this leap, and it's from outside it looks something that's very fun and exciting. So the independence, the low hierarchy, the freedom to do things very ambitiously, to set the bar in international level, is very exciting, and it creates places where people can feel that they are doing purposeful job, they are changing the world, they are solving the problems, and it gives empowerment to the people. So that's one of the most interesting aspects, I think, in startup culture. It creates excitement and this drive.
And ambition and, yes. and so on. So it's nourishing by itself,
yes.
isn't it? So, yeah.
Yes. And then also the, at its best, startup culture can be very low hierarchy. If there is still a small founder team, we all like to work with our friends. It's, yeah. So it's a small group of like-minded people. That's the stereotype, maybe. So that's the benefit.
And that's also the power that drives the startup, that there is a small hierarchy, that people work together, they have a common idea, and this is, isn't it?
Yes, and also some pivoting can be very fast-paced. Mm. So sometimes when people get frustrated in big corporations for the bureaucracy or the slow pace of progress, then at the same time, startups' timeline can be very timid. Like when a corporation does things in years, so the startup's pace can be like, this can be done in months. Yeah. So it's for me, who I don't have temper for waiting for so long. So then the startup energy and the pace is so
inspiring.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
So, Elena, you have also investigated the downside of this culture, or you have observed some problems and written about it, very interesting articles. Can you tell us about this more dark side, maybe, of this culture?
Mm-hmm. Of course, we all would want to imagine that everything is nice and just puppies and unicorns in the startups. That's not the case. So I have done some investigative journalism about the problems that Finnish growth companies and startups have had. And I would divide them to three categories, like the more general level cultural problems that might be typical in this, what is called Silicon Valley or Tech Pro, or like just very high-paced, very ambitious culture. Like, and then there's a level where the problems in the culture can escalate to legal problems. Then the level where the culture can be toxic, there can be sexual harassment, like the Tech Pro culture, where there can be harassment or like this kind of or discrimination based on different minority statuses, for example. And then there are the worst case scenarios, the situation where the startups don't follow any work laws of in Finland, for example, or the where is actual discrimination that's legally problematic, or even exploitation of employees. So the three categories all exist in Finnish startup community, and of course that's a problem, and we need to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. I think this is very interesting, because I'm interested in escalation of problems and how you can prevent them. So this is very interesting what you said, that let's say that a certain type of culture might lead to an escalation of problems on the legal side, might turn into legal problems at some point, might be relevant also for people who investors also. And then even there are the worst cases scenarios where they really do not follow the law. If we talk about this, you investigated this lower category. What do you think leads then to the second? What are the problems in the first one? And what do you think would then lead to the second stage? Or what's the risk there?
Well, if we take the more general level first, an example of problems in that level would be ISAI, a company that I wrote recently. they had young engineer founders who were very professional in the space technology. But if you take two guys in their 20s who have never had a job before, who have no experience of a company, building a culture, how is it to be an employee? And then they have this vision and highly ambitious idea. They start recruiting people from different countries like them, like engineers in their 20s, or perhaps male. Well, it sums up to a culture where there might be 60 different nationalities. Hi, we have this multicultural team, but they all are same age group, male, from a similar background, and they all have like sleepovers at the office. And they don't see the problem they are creating, that it's not inclusive. It's a place where you need to, they don't mind any work laws, like when you go home, or what's realistic expectation for employer, what's normal. So that can bring problems when people don't feel comfortable, when they get burned out, when they feel that there's a weak or bad culture, and they start leaving the company. If your key people leaves, then you start having this high rotation. And of course, it creates you a business problem. How do you build a growth company successfully in long term if your people are leaving because they are burnout or they don't feel comfortable? So it's also a business risk.
Yes. So what you say is that there's a different kind of normal, what is considered normal in this environment sometimes or often, which leads to this very inspiring environment, but has also the problem that then the owners who are not, might not be aware of what is normal in a for other people and within the legal society maybe or so on. And that's a kind of a subculture maybe.
Exactly. Yes, the Silicon Valley subculture that's neglecting the normal rules of work life.
Yeah. Yeah. Which then creates problems as you grow. So, of course, you always said so. You always need to comply with the law, but which creates problems as they grow and hire people, and then of course they would need some more processes, standards, and so on to survive.
The growth pains are normal in the industry. It's difficult and we have had the pandemic and situation where companies like ISAI have gone from 100 people to 500 people during these two years of remote work and pandemic. So there would be growth pains and in creating processes and needing to build the company structure and building the company culture anyway. But it has been extra difficult during this time.
Yeah.
And then if we go to the second level, that would be case Swapi, for example. Mm-hmm. A similar case, like two guys founding a company and then maybe being kind of blind to the culture that's happening in the company. Again, if you hire fast pace, a lot of people, you can make wrong decisions in recruiting, then those people can be creating some subculture inside the company that you don't intend to. And if there are, like, let's say, some very masculine guys from Latino cultures, you need to have this cultural education. Mm-hmm. What are the rules in Scandinavian, very equal inclusive work environment, that you can't talk sexistic things, you can't flirt in this way, you can't approach your female colleagues in that way, or things like that. So Swapi had that kind of issues. That led to a legal process. Mm-hmm. And if not taken seriously, like educating your people, setting the standards, if you forget to repeatedly tell the people that these are our rules, these are our values, this is our cultural, and have the common agreement on that, then it can lead to problems.
Oh. And these problems come mostly, or they grow at least, when the startup starts to be successful and hires a lot of people. Then this like different standards, different within the company, and lack of process, that these problems accumulate. And this is probably for the founders, it might come even as a surprise that this doesn't work out. So.
Yes. Yeah. And that's why if I would be a founder and building a founder team, I would think, is my founder team diverse enough?
Yeah.
Like if I have four like-minded guys at the same age from same school, are we blind to some cultural problems? Do we hire people that are diverse? And then it's different to just work as a group of founders. You all have the stakes in it. You are passionate about. If you have ownership, you can do round hours.
Yes.
But then it's different when you have employers, and if you have responsibilities for them, and they can't have the same ownership. They don't get the similar kind of payoff from it.
Yes, exactly. You recently also wrote about problems in a company that hired foreigners. So are foreigners or immigrants, we will have a lot of immigrants in the future, hopefully in Finland, who want to work here and contribute to the society, are they more exposed than Finns to this kind of culture?
Yes, they are. It is something that we should talk more. That at the same time, when we want to have foreign experts, we need to have foreign employers in our growth companies, and we are trying to attract them to move to Finland. So we need to build workplaces that are actually inclusive to them, that are actually treating them well, so that they can flourish. I wrote a piece about a company called Rens, but it's not the only company that has similar problems. It was just more severe. In this case, the company is designing these trainers' shoes, and they started recruiting more Vietnamese, as a trainees, like young people coming to Finland and needing a job. And they were exploiting the vulnerable position. And they offered jobs with just pay of hundreds of thousands. Like the pay was from 500 to 700 euros per month, or
so at very low.
Salary. Very low, like illegally low. Then there were exploitation that they were promising, if you work hard, you can get permanent job and then you can apply a visa. So that was the exploitation that was actually legally problematic here. And discrimination. So there are even companies like that, but that's very rare.
Mm-hmm.
More problem. Magic is that the foreign employees who come here aren't aware of Finnish work laws. They are not aware of collective agreements.
Yes.
They don't know what rights they have. there are these and these rules, and this belongs to me. I have right to this. So when the startups have this Silicon Valley style culture that we, these rules don't apply to me, like the neglecting the standards, the employees don't have networks in Finland that would support them. They don't have the support network. So they are vulnerable when they are when their income relies to that company. So a lot of them work harder, they do longer hours, and they don't know their rights. Mm. So startups should really like educate the people of their rights and be good employers to be able to attract a foreign workforce.
Exactly. So it's often a lack of information. On the one side, there is no access to information or difficult access for foreigners. You have no network, like people who have lived here for a long time. They know people, and everybody is more or less aware of the legislation and the protection given under the law and bargaining agreements, collective agreements. And for foreigners, this might be or is in general more difficult. So it's a lack of information. It's also, let's say, a lack of access to information, a lack of giving information or educating people from the side of the startup.
Yes, yeah. Yes. And not we as a journalist, we love these stories, like two young immigrants found this cool shoe startup in Finland, and this nice Cinderella story of like, but then we also need to realize that not all the immigrant communities are nice to each other. There might be structures that lead to exploitation inside the community, like in Nepalese restaurants. That's like the most common example. Mm. Or in the cleaning industry, you would suspect that there can be gray workforce or problems. But you wouldn't suspect that in a high technology startup.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But that also has some similarities, that people who come from abroad are more vulnerable. Yeah.
So while it is not a very general problem, it's an important problem we need to talk more about. That's what you want to say?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
So we have been now talking quite much about the bad examples, but Can you tell us what is kind of, in your view, kind of an ideal startup culture? Are there some positive examples as well?
Yes, of course, and there are lots of them. We have been writing during the years about companies like Smartly, ad technology company that has been very success story. Also, an example of good leadership and good and systematic culture building, how they set up a culture book since day one. Like they have the organization where even the CEO has to do the basic level job once in a time to know the actual problems of their customers. By his example, he is leading the company in a way that has created this positive environment. And I think one of the examples in that company was that while he was also a young male in his 20s, but he was able to empower his people and rise up. Like all the young people he hired, they got big roles, big shoes, that they had lots of power to do what they felt wise. And in that, the low hierarchy in the company made it flourish eventually. And then companies like Supermetrics and Relex can be good examples too. In a way, they treat very international workforce very positive way, very relaxed way, and take care of the international employers very fair way. And if you think about the ownership structures, for example, it has become like standard in this kind of companies that everyone has shares. So when there's exits, for example, when there's a possibility to sell some shares, everyone will win something. So, for example, when the games company Rovio had IPO, that was the family-owned company. The head family owned majority, and they cashed to IPO. It was example of like unfair thing to do. But when Supercell sold the company, everyone had some shares. Okay. So all of the employers were cashing it. So the level of fairness and who's in this growth, how does it get me involved? There's a difference of how to do things. So to summarize the things that or learnings from these would be like, think about your founding team. Is it diverse? Who are the founders? What kind of culture you are creating by example? And then the culture book, what are our values? What is our culture and how we are creating it? Like in concrete daily level, how do we operate? And where does it, the culture, where is it seen? And then having a toolbox, like real inclusive and diversity toolbox and educating people of these issues repeatedly. Those would be the founding stones of how to, since day one, start thinking of building long-term success that has less growth pains when you start scaling up.
That's an important point, that you should start from day one to build this culture, not only when you hire the first employees, but you need to think about it.
It's not something that your human resources can then imply to a company when you're already a big, like 500 people. Then you have a problem if you start thinking about the culture when you end that level.
Yeah. How should a startup kind of take care of their relationships with media?
Well, that is important also if you think about risk management. And if a company has a bad culture and if it leads to problems, then you have a brand risk in like if there's bad publicity. But you shouldn't think it as that that's something we need to hide. But you need to think it differently. We as a journalist, we don't do companies' PR. Yeah. We are not telling only the nice things. We are also the watchdogs. We have responsibility to our audience and the role in society to take care that also the vulnerable people, like the foreign employers, get their voice heard. So it's our task to ask also hard questions. That's the role of journalism. And some problems, there can be some conflicts between growth companies and journalism if that role is not understood. So as important as it is to be inclusive and open in your own company culture so that there wouldn't be any problems, then if you anyway end up having problems, the right way to handle the situation is inside your company to take the problem seriously, show that you are responding to the problems. You have a process to handle the issues. Then you take right steps and try to replace, repair the things. And towards journalism, you need to be also open and transparent and show your responsibility. Apologize if there's need to. Show what you are doing and regain the trust, both from your employers and from the audience. So I would take very seriously if you hear some problems, and then not to take this very defensive, protective denial, but to be humble and think what went wrong, how can we repair it, and how do we communicate it openly and transparently and show that we are trying our best.
So this has been a very exciting talk. So what are the key takeaways of this?
I would say that the startups and growth companies can be very empowering, very inspiring places to work. There can be very strong culture that leads to moonshot companies, to some unicorns that we, after 10 years, look as success stories. That I get to interview all these very exciting founders. But there are also some problems that can be avoided if you take care of the culture since day one. And there are legal issues that can be avoided if you think how important part building a culture is to avoid it escalating to legal problems.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Elina. That was very interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you.